And let me set the stage for you. Now imagine, if you will, a time before YouTube, a time before Google. There was no search engine like that. Salon.com and boingboing.net had only been on the web for about 2 years, and the Huffington Post was like a pipe dream. It wouldn't occur for another decade or so. And Facebook, it was not even a twinkle in those Winkle Twins' eyes. So things were very different. Even email was not all that common, believe it or not. You wouldn't ask people for their email address. You would ask them, are you on email? So this is not that long ago. This is in our lifetimes. This is less than 20 years ago. Nobody had smartphones, nobody texted, and even cell phones weren't that prevalent. So digitally speaking, this was a completely different world. Are there children here? There may even have been less porn. I'm just saying. So back in 1997, Brett Savory started up this little website called, and again, are there kids here? Okay, this website called the Sick Fuckers Club. I'm not making this up. So it was basically for people who read horror and dark fantasy, and often people who wrote it. There weren't a lot of well-known or published authors in there, but Brett was ambitious. He wanted to build up the site, and he wanted to get people to join, be part of the club, so you could talk about dark genre fiction and what to do with it, where to sell it, what to do. It was kind of the equivalent as if you were the new kid on the block and knocking on people's doors going, will you be my friend? And surprisingly enough, people said, yes, I will totally be your friend, and I will join the club. So he started asking famous writers to join, you know, like people like Anne Rice and Stephen King, Peter Straub, and so on. You know, most of these people said no. But the really nice thing is that Peter Crowther, this well-known poet and writer and publisher in England, actually said, okay, you know what, I'm going to join, but you can't call it the Sick Fuckers Club anymore. You have to call it something else. Let's try to be professional here. So he sent Brett a list of words that he thought would kind of exemplify the kind of thing that Brett was trying to do, and Brett's favorite word from that list was chiaroscuro, which, as I'm sure most of you know, is a painting term, treatment of light and shade with paint. And so he thought, well, that's what it's going to be. It's going to be treatment of light and shade in words. And so chiaroscuro magazine eventually became ChiZine, although technically I guess it should be ChiZine, and I've heard it pronounced every single way in the world, ChiZine, 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 you know, that's when it's in French. But, you know, it started to get known a little bit, and people started to join up, and they were members of the club, and you could get, it was like an early predecessor to Facebook, like the dark Facebook in a weird way, because you could have your photo on there, your interests, the books that you like, this sort of thing, connect with other people. All in kind of a small way, but it was starting to be something. And so it grew every year. People joined. People started to join from all over the world. This is a forum for people who read and wrote dark fiction, a place for them to talk about that and also about movies. And they wrote movie reviews, book reviews. There was art and photography and all kinds of interesting things on there. And then in 1999, Brett decided that he was going to start paying people for the stuff that they gave him. So people were giving him short fiction, and he thought, you know, I'm gonna pay you. But he couldn't really pay them much. So it was like a cent a word. It wasn't much. And in 1999, I met Brett, and I said, let's do some poetry, because, you know, everyone loves poetry. And the poets got paid the glorious sum of $2 a poem. So granted, there's a lot of free poetry on the web, and a lot of it was very bad. But, you know, we were actually going to pay people. And so, you know, we kind of had an actual little magazine then, and it started to be like, okay, we're going to do it regularly, it's going to be quarterly, and we're going to pay people, and we'll go from there. We kind of had a brand, and so we kept that up for a few years, this little quarterly zine that people were starting to talk about, and then one day Brett had this great idea. He said, let's get a sponsor, like a Renaissance patron. Let's get someone to pay the bills so we don't actually have to think about this, so we can be artistes and not worry about petty little things like money. So I was like, fantastic, let's get somebody else to pay the bills. You know, I love that idea. So we got somebody. We got Leisure Books. I don't know if you've heard of them. They are a division of, or were a division of Dorchester Publishing, and they agreed to be our sponsor in 2000, and they gave us money to pay all the contributors, and the editors still weren't getting anything. But the word rate went up a little bit, and we paid what then was a pro rate at the time, which in 2000 was 3 cents a word, which still really isn't that much money. But this, This was in U.S. dollars. Anyway, so Alicia was actually very good to us, and then when the prorate was officially listed as 5 cents a word, they said, sure, we'll actually give you more money. And then Brett said, how about an honorarium for the staff? You know, all these editors and slush readers and people who, you know, are doing reviews, and they're really not getting anything. Can we give them something? And Alicia said, okay, sure, why not? Because it wasn't really costing them much money. I think it worked out to be maybe $3,000 to $4,000 a year. It wasn't a lot for them, for a big publishing house. And, you know, they got to have their banner ads on there. And so they got a little bit of a profile. And they were kind of sponsoring, at least what we thought, was kind of a quality magazine. We had good, dark fiction on the web. People were starting to notice ChiZine.com, like I said, and they were talking about it. And then this really crazy thing happened was that we got nominated for the Bram Stoker Award, which for horror writers is like, you know, it's like a known award. And we were really shocked that we even got nominated because we were like, I didn't know anybody was reading us, but okay. And then something else happened. We friggin' won. So that was a huge. We were so surprised by this that we had no plan at all. We had no speeches. I think we sat there with our mouths open, and then people were like, "Go up, go get the award." And I think that Brett's acceptance speech consisted of, "This fucking rocks," and that was it. It wasn't really a club anymore. It was a genuine e-zine, and people were listing it in the market listings as a place that you could sell your fiction and poetry to that paid you a pro rate, which meant that if you sold to us, you got an official publication credit that you could use to get membership to places like the Science Fiction Writers of America, the Horror Writers Association, SF Canada. Once we got that status, we didn't want to lose that. So eventually we ended up until last year, or up until now, I guess technically, we're at 7 cents a word and $10 a poem, which is not a bad road from free, not paying you a single thing. So then the economy tanked. So, but yeah, we were okay. Like, we kept paying everyone. Things were good. Leisure was sending the checks. It was all fine until the day that they stopped sending the checks. So they said they were just a little bit behind, but the money was coming. They literally told us, I kid you not, that the check is in the mail. And they told us this many times. And that went on for a while until finally about, I guess it was maybe August of last year, we got an email saying, yeah, we're not going to sponsor you anymore. And then we said, well, that would have been really nice to know a few months ago when we would have made the deadline for applying for funding. But, oh well. So, anyway. So we thought, okay, we've got to do something else. What are we going to do? We have a brand. We have a recognizable brand. People who read in the genre know who we are, and we don't want to lose that. We've got a lot of goodwill. We don't want to squander that either. What can we do? And we thought, well, it's been a long time, and the zine has looked the same for a long time. We're going to redesign the whole thing. And we did that. We did a whole redesign and relaunch. We actually didn't do the January issue, so the January through March issue, so that we could just rebuild everything, and then we decided to have a big fundraiser. And we asked everybody who had been a ChiZine alumni who sold us poetry and promo poems and book reviews and all sorts of things, and said, will you donate something to us for this big issue? You'd send us something for free. And people actually sent us original stuff for free. We've got a lot of reprints, but we've got original stuff. And we had the little fundraising thermometer and everything. And we raised the money. We raised enough money so that we could pay for the rest of the year, which was great. Except once again, the editors got nothing because there was no money for that. We could still pay the authors' pro rates, which is what mattered to us, but we could not pay the poor editors. So that's where we ended up. And we're still waiting for that leisure check, and we're looking for advertisers. So the thing is that this is one of the ways that I feel that we kind of went wrong. You know, I mean, a lot of really great writers got their start with ChiZine and went on to do get great publishing deals, and, you know, became quite well known. And we had people like Peter Straub and Neil Gaiman and people like that who knew who we were, who donated stories to us and kind of helped us out in that way, which was really terrific. But here's the thing. What happened in the meantime, if I can go back a few years, is that in 2008, Brett, who actually ended up being my husband, said to me, what do you think about doing ChiZine as a print publication? I said, the magazine. And he said, no, like, let's actually have a publishing company. Let's publish books. What do you think? And, you know, once again, I said, yeah, fuck it, let's do it. which is how all great business decisions should be made, I feel. So we thought, okay, why not? Let's do it. And so what we started to do was we'll do four books a year, you know, by Canadians, and then we can get that juicy, you know, Canada Council and Ontario Arts Council funding. Let's do that. So that was great. We did a few books, and we were gonna just keep going like that. And then the economy went to the toilet, and Brett got fired from Scholastic. So we thought, that's great. So we should really scale back. And then we said, no, screw it. Let's do it whole hog. We're not gonna sit back. We're not gonna do less. We're gonna do more. So rather than doing four books a year, we're going to go from like four to six books a year, we're going to go to 12 books a year. Brett's going to do it full time. I still have my day job. It's like, now's the time to do it, you know. While the economy is in the crapper and nobody has any money, this is the perfect time to start a new business. So we did that, and again, we were kind of surprised. We ended up getting distribution in Canada, and then we got distribution in the US and internationally, and ChiZine Publications was a hit. And people were buying our books. People liked our books. It was amazing. And the thing was, we had a business plan, but we weren't really mercenary about it. What we wanted to do was basically, you know, put out the books that we really love, the books that we love to read. And we knew a whole bunch of writers because we were writers ourselves. And we wanted to get those books out to people. We started the Chiaroscuro reading series, and that runs the second Wednesday of every month and has been going almost a year now. ChiZine.com is still going. It's still there. It's weird because now it's been going for 14 years, and it feels like it's this sort of gentle elderly lady that's sort of, you know, still wearing her goth boots, but, you know, should maybe take a back seat for a while, because, you know, are we really doing anything new? Because the publishing company was going well, reading series going well, other stuff going well, ChiZine.com, lagging. So here's the thing. People on the internet want stuff for free. So the zine has been free all this time. So we can't exactly say, oh, now we want to subscribe. We want you to subscribe to it, but we're still going to give you exactly the same stuff you always got, but now you need to pay. So we couldn't do that. If we wanted people to pay, we would have had to give them something truly spectacular and short of, you know, I don't know, strippers, you know, we really couldn't think of anything. The last thing that I think that we did wrong was that we were coming at it from print-based thinking. It was a quarterly magazine, that is a print-based idea. The internet is infinite for all practical human purposes. That is something that I think we are not exploiting, the infinity of that concept. Because human beings are mortal, we don't think in terms of what lasts forever. The people who think of things that last forever are corporations, religious institutions, vampires, Walt Disney with his frozen head, if that actually happened. But we tend not to think that way, and I think that we have to. We have to think about the fact that every internet project needs to be rejigged, like every 6 months minimum, because everything is instantaneous, and we know that. I mean, we know it's instantaneous and people have no attention span, but in fact, people are reading more now than they have ever in history, ever. I'm not just a percentage of population, you know, if you compare it throughout the years, just generally, the percentage is even higher now. People are more literate. That's an amazing thing. You know, books aren't going away, stories aren't going away, poetry is still here. Sure, some of it's crap, but it's still around. So we have to think about that, and we have to, you know, and everything is over so quickly too. It's infinite, but it's not. Remember MySpace? And, you know, and now Facebook is going. I mean, and that's the other thing to remember, is that you have to be flexible, but don't make changes that are stupid, like Facebook. So I guess to say, in conclusion, that's all the stuff we did wrong, and now we are trying to fix it so we can be hundredaires again. And I think that basically if you have no boundaries, or your boundaries are infinite, then, you know, what can you do? Or rather, what can't you do? And I think that that is the key to making your e-zine a success. And that's the end of my talk.